welcome to the March 18, 1997 Town of Cape Elizabeth Planning Board meeting. The first order of business is the minutes of the previous meeting of February the 18th. Do any board members have any comments? I have just a couple for Alice on page 3. The last paragraph, Mr. Vaniotis said in regard to protecting views, that, I think we can strike the second that. And two paragraphs above that, actually, he noticed that the easement to go over the Snow's property, I think it should be S apostrophe rather than apostrophe S, but I don't think that's worth really paying much attention to. And the only other something that I wanted to note is that on page 6, the first, or the second paragraph, Mr. Dewan's name is D-E capital W-A-N. Other than that, I have no changes. Does anybody else have any? Here, Ron, do I hear a motion? You have a hand up in the air.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I didn't know quite how to interpret.
No, I
fair enough.
Move for approval as amended.
Fair enough. All in favor? Raise your right hand.
Right.
Excellent. The correspondence received since the previous meeting, a letter from Mr. and Mrs. Haffenreffer about the town center development, a letter from Hobstone Owners Association regarding the Hobstone conservation land. We also have in our packets the planning board goals for 1997, which were approved at the last meeting, a letter from Mary Rich regarding the ball fields, a memo from the code enforcement administrator regarding Pacuta Drive public access waiver, memo from Officer Dyer regarding the same project, a letter from Captain Williams regarding the same project at Pacuta Drive, and a memo from Chief McGoldrick regarding Pacuta Drive. Back from the Brink notice, excerpts provided by the town planner regarding the Telecommunications Act of 1996, an article, Zoning News, from February of 1997, and the Marsh's Edge article. Excuse me. Several of those articles I thought were really quite good this time around. The first order, or the next order of business, I should say, this evening is the Dominicus Crossing subdivision request by Dominicus Crossing Limited Liability Company for final subdivision review and a wetland alteration permit for Dominicus Crossing, a 97 lot plus one multifamily unit subdivision located on Wells Road and Sawyer Road, under section 16-2-4, major subdivision review, public hearing, and section 19-3-9, a wetland alteration permit, public hearing. In order to introduce the proceedings this evening, I'd like to ask the town planner to tell us very briefly how we got to this point and what's on the schedule from here.
This is a major subdivision which requires preliminary and final subdivision review. The board granted preliminary subdivision review last August. The applicant has returned with a DEP permit and is now applied for final subdivision approval. Planning board has scheduled a public hearing for this evening.
Thank you. Mr. Dewan, or your able assistant, would you like to introduce the project this time around prior to the opening of the public hearing?
Thank you, Madam Chair. My name is Terry Dewan. I'm a landscape architect in Yarmouth, here on behalf of Dominicus Crossing Limited Liability Company. And we're here tonight to introduce the project and to open the discussion for the public hearing. Just to underscore your request to keep it brief, because I know this is not the first time that you've heard this presentation. I will go over probably most of the information we presented last time in very outline form, and will rely upon the audience out there to ask questions if that's the wish of the board, in an effort to keep it as brief as possible. What we have done tonight is we will provide you with an overview of the project. As you know, we did provide a letter that was a response to many of the questions that were raised at the last planning board meeting. Along with that letter came a number of additional studies, some additional submittal information. We have some additional things here tonight which you've not yet seen. We're also going to talk a little bit more about a minor revision to the DEP and the Army Corps of Engineers permit, and we'll let you know the status of that.
Very good.
Okay. So, do you have to formally open the public hearing, or is it now in progress?
Standard practice here, I think, Mr. DeWan, is to have you introduce the project, and then we'll open the public hearing for public comment.
Thank you very much. As you know, Dominguez Crossing LLC was granted preliminary subdivision approval last August. In the intervening time, we've made our presentation and application to the DEP and the Corps of Engineers. We have received all the permits that we need at those two levels of government, and we're here before you tonight for final subdivision approval for the subdivision and for the wetland alteration permit. Dominguez Crossing, of course, is a residential subdivision. It will consist of 98 residential units and 97 lots off of Wells Road and Wells Road and Sawyer Road on a 205.94 acre parcel. Of that total, approximately 105 and a half acres will be developed as house lots and roadways, and there'll be roughly 100 acres of land dedicated as open space and for a variety of recreation facilities. Within this open space, as you're aware of, we are developing all but 1.2 acres of land as pretty much undisturbed, undeveloped open space. The 1.2 acres of land will consist of two common greens, a half-court basketball area, and an informal picnic area. The remaining 99.4 acres of land will be dedicated as open space. It's a mixture of mature hardwoods, some softwoods, and some forested wetlands. About 35 acres of this 100-plus acre of open space are wetlands, and they're found interwoven throughout the project. We've described in great detail the trail network that's going to be designed and as an integral part of the open space system, and it's being designed also to interconnect with other elements of the Cape Elizabeth Greenbelt system. They'll provide linear connections not only within our subdivision, but also throughout the rest of the Cape. There will not be any additional recreation facilities constructed within this dedicated open space. We also, as you know from the last time, are naming the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust as a party that will hold an easement to the property. We met with the Conservation Commission earlier this week. We intend to go back to the town council. I don't know the exact date yet. We're hoping that's March 24th. And at that point, we will make the presentation once again in terms of presenting the plan that shows which elements of the infrastructure in the open space will be turned over to the town for conditional municipal approval. Just very briefly, the Cape Elizabeth Comprehensive Plan in 1993 designated the majority of this property as a growth area. When the town designated this as one of its growth areas, they looked at the protection of the rural protection areas, the relative suitability of soils for the subsurface disposal systems, the current or potential availability of public sewer service, the proximity to existing established residential neighborhoods in the community. And we feel this fits in very well to the town's long-term intent to develop areas that have been designated as growth areas. Just as an overview of the types of housing that will be built out here, the 98 residential units consist of one existing single-family home that now belongs to Juan Perez, who is one of the partners in Dominguez Crossing. That's located on lot number one in Wells Road. There is an existing barn that's located adjacent to Juan's house that has an existing apartment in it. The application includes adding one additional apartment to that barn unit. There'll be 90 new single-family market-rate homes to be constructed on individual lots, and there'll be five units of affordable housing, and those consist of two-family units, or for a total of four units. It'll be located on lots 26 and 27, lots 66 and 67, There's also a single-family home on Lot 55. The homes in the subdivision will be built by Anastas and Lonis of Yarmouth. Peter Anastas is here tonight, and he can answer any questions regarding the design of any of the homes that will be built out here. The project will be developed in five phases, with lots ranging from 0.18 acres, which is one of the affordable housing lots, to 4.72 acres land. The first phase will consist of 32 new housing units. That includes two existing units, 4.9 acres of open space, and about half a mile of roadway. And that's Alicia Circle and a portion of Dominicus Crossing. The second phase has 11 homes and about 5.5 acres of open space, and that's Lorenzo Lane, which is the section right here. This is phase one up through here, phase two right here. Phase three has 8 units with 2.5 acres of open space and another 0.2 miles of Dominicus Crossing and some related infrastructure. Phase four, which has 25 homes and about 25 acres of open space and about half a mile of road, which is Thomas Road, Chesterwood Trail, and the remainder of Dominicus Crossing, going all the way over to Sawyer. The final phase, phase five, will have 20 new homes built on half a mile of new roads, and that has 62 acres of open space. Dominicus Crossing is served by public sewer and public water on all homes, except lot 63, this lot right here, on Sawyer Road, and we have had that tested for on-site disposal. And that's how that lot will be serviced. At this point, unless you beg me otherwise, I will turn the presentation back over to the chair for the public hearing portion. We do have a lot of information to make regarding the submittal we made several weeks ago and the other things which have been going on relative to DEP and the Corps of Engineers. So,
thank you, Mr. DeWan. I think that this would be an appropriate time to stop the initial presentation. And without further ado, I will now open the public hearing. And anyone who wishes to speak, please come forward and state your name and let us hear from you. Is there anybody in the audience who wishes to be heard? Ms. Therrien. You can tell us about that when you get to the podium.
I can assure you, but you shouldn't take it personally, that I would rather not be here. My name is Suzanne Van Wy, and I live at 49 Wells Road. I'm here tonight in order to continue to be included in the public record, expressing my concerns regarding this development, and particularly its effect on me. As the abutter, everybody seems to agree is going to be the most negatively impacted. Even the town manager has suggested that I move. Although I have serious ambivalence and misgivings about the entire project, I chose from the outset to oppose only what I felt was obviously unfair, which is the major access road to the development. I just want to show you, to remind you of the letters I've written, understanding that you've done a superb job, and you have limited jurisdiction. And I actually have been enlightened and informed by this whole process. I'm no longer as naive as I was, that's for sure. But it has been an experience for me that from which I've learned a lot. And I'm sure my hair wasn't this gray 2.5 years ago when it began. So a letter of October 3rd, 1995. January 9th, 1996, February 13th, 1996, April 9th, 1996, and this one, April 16th. This cost me quite a bit of money. I didn't have the machinery to do this at my home. I also, as you know, incurred the expense of hiring a civil engineer and, of course, a lawyer. January 9th, 1996, April 9th, 1996, and May 16th. I know you read, and July 16th, 1996. I know you all read these letters. I know you expressed your concerns about what I was going to endure as a result of this development, and you took it to heart. And I do know that things do not happen behind closed doors. I'm aware of that to some extent. I continue to be concerned. Let me just say that I think that there's a fundamental flaw in our laws, not only in Cape Elizabeth zoning ordinance and comprehensive plan, but there's something fundamentally flawed when an individual is victimized by another individual's desire for gain. So somebody is going to make a lot of money to some extent at my expense. And there's something fundamentally flawed in the way in which we do business that allows that to happen. And that's really my message tonight. In terms of what you do have some jurisdiction over, I continue to be concerned about the phasing. Roy Carlson mentioned it at one meeting, and questions were asked, and I don't think that that has been followed up on to the extent that I would like to see it followed up. I see no reason why phase two can't be phase four or five. Phase one, which is 34 homes, 32 homes, whatever, 2 years of building surrounding my home. I understand that, but I don't see any reason why the Sawyer Street entrance can't be become the access for construction, given your ability to permit that to happen after phase one or two. I'm also very concerned that Mr. Perez now is interested in having a driveway into Lot 22, his desired home, which was one of the sites that Mr. DeWan had suggested as a possible alternative to the road that I objected to, and it was rejected as not having adequate site distance. But now Mr. Perez is expressing an interest in having that as an entrance driveway to his home. I will be very upset if that's allowed. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak at the public hearing? Don't be bashful. Anybody else who wants to come forward? You're all here for something else besides the public hearing. Okay. Hearing no further participation, I will now close the public hearing and ask Mr. DeWan to continue with this presentation.
So first I'd like to start by talking about some of the exhibits that we have on the wall. And these were things that we prepared in direct response to many of the concerns that were voiced last time. And I'll just, in no particular order, start with the,
Good catch.
Thank you, Mark. There's always been some discussion about what the first phase is going to look like, given the fact that the lots are relatively narrow, the fact that some question was raised about how many trees could be preserved along the road and so forth. By the first phase, I mean this area through here, along Dominica's Crossing. And so it was asked, show us a site plan that will illustrate what the houses will look like. And in our cover letter, we also said that we would bring before you elevations of homes that have been built in other somewhat similar situations. These are five homes that were built on a project that we designed many years ago called Village Brook, which is one of Yarmouth's first cluster subdivisions. The houses are all approximately 40 feet, 50 feet in width there. The lots are wide enough, so the houses are probably some places 50 feet wide, some places more like 60 or 70 feet wide. What we've done is taken photographs of the houses, enlarged them to all the same scale, and put them on the plot plan, or put them on this diagram right here, to show you what the first phase will look like. These houses right here, these five homes here, are the five homes that we're showing right here. So this is the view that someone who's standing in the proposed common green right here as part of phase one will see as they look across the road. This is the sidewalk, this is the curb line right here. About every 40 feet we have a proposed tree, assuming that that the trees that are out there right now probably will not survive the introduction of the sidewalk and utilities. There is some vegetation on the property right now. Again, this is from another site. We're representing the vegetation on this diagram here. It's somewhat loose and scattered, but in the backdrop, which is how we know it to be out in the field, there are a lot of white pines or a lot of white birches and other vegetation that will act as a nice backdrop. What we don't show on here, obviously, are our driveways, although you can probably imagine one's right here. There's another one down here. Probably should have shown a driveway in this right here. But I think the overall intent is to give you a sense of what the homes might be like, given the fact that the lots are fairly narrow here. The houses are going to have to be designed to be fit onto this type of situation. In all cases here, we're showing houses that have garages, but they're not highly visible from the road. That's a garage right there. It's entered from the side. The garage over here is entered at a lower level. This is actually the garage right here in the front of the house, and you enter it from the side. So I think it's possible, given the size of the lots we're proposing here, given the type of housing that will probably be built on here, to have a very nice residential neighborhood that will help define this common green. And here's an enlargement of the green down here. We have shown the trees as what they'll probably look like after, say, 4 or 5 years. We do have a sidewalk going through here with an esplanade of about 5 feet in this location. Our overall impression is that it'll be a very attractive neighborhood. Someone asked the question, what happens if someone wants to build what someone called a phase five house on one of these lots? I think it's probably possible to do that. It'll be a lot more dense. My immediate impression when we put this diagram together is that you probably could have a little bit more massive buildings between the buildings right here. In other words, the village probably could appear to be a little bit closer together, and it would still feel like a very cohesive neighborhood. Since we're trying to create a space that's going to require some definition other than the trees and the woods and the backdrop. So our impression is that it's going to be a very attractive way to enter the community, and this is what we intend to see it look like. There was also a question raised about the stormwater management pond that will be built adjacent to Wells Road down here. And that was a question that was raised at the last meeting. I know Mark, for one, raised the question about, well, what about this big riprap channel that will take the water from the wet pond and the upper level down the slope and then into the lower pond right there? What are you going to see as you go down Wells Road? Well, that was a good observation, and it's one thing that we were always very uncomfortable about, the fact that you were taking fairly large pieces of riprap and using that to prevent erosion in the long term. In checking with our engineers and checking with SCS, we felt that there was a better way of doing it. So the detail that we're showing right now still has the riprap in place, but there will be a layer of what's called permamat and topsoil on top of the riprap. The topsoil will be used to establish a catch of grass. You'll still have the riprap there for long-term stability. The permamet is a geotextile material that will help hold the topsoil and the grass in place. So it will act as a reinforced grass channel when it's called upon to transfer water from the upper pond down to the lower pond. We also took a look at the planting plan that was proposed for this area. And we've added several additional evergreen trees. We're showing right here some additional hemlock trees. So the view to the pond from Wells Road will be partially screened by this additional planting. We are showing quite a few shrubs and some new trees also to be introduced into this area. Again, with the notion of trying to soften the work that will have to be done to create these detention ponds. There is the driveway that is going to be incorporated into the design of the facility here. You can see it in the cross section, how it will be built on the berm that helps form the upper wet pond. That will be provided to give an access point to the housing site, which is located on the upper portion of this lot. And the other thing which we've done, because there's a possibility that several of the oak trees along Wells Road may have to come down as part of the construction of this, we are proposing to plant some additional oak trees back along Wells Road. You can see a line of them right here and right here. These two diagrams actually almost go together. That line goes up to right there to give you a sense of what this will look like in the overall effect. There was also a question raised about the site planning for the affordable housing lots. Lot 55, which is the single family affordable housing site, lots 66 and 67, and lots 26 and 27. We've taken each of the homes that are being proposed for these specific locations, a single Cape style home, a more federal style home, and an expanded Cape, and have shown those in site plan form as well as elevation form. You've gotten the elevation drawings before, and we've provided you, as part of this application, a package which shows how the driveways would work, how the lot lines will be located, the amount of setback that would typically be done. The setback for this pair of houses that will be done as part of phase one will be set, so it will be a 10-foot setback from the edge of the right-of-way. There's a little bit more latitude in these other two situations here, but generally, the way you're looking at it in these diagrams will be how they'll be located on the properties. We've done enough grading and enough landscaping on the property to know that they will fit, and that will be a very attractive housing location for both of these situations. There was also a question raised regarding the type of light fixture that will be used. Because this is a part of the infrastructure that will be turned over to the town, ultimately, we're proposing to use the Central Maine Power Company, what's called their colonial light fixture, which is used in a lot of subdivisions that are being done throughout Cumberland County in the last several years. We have shown in other diagrams the locations of the light fixtures. That we're not using a lot of lights, just at key locations. Relative to the trees that we're planting and the existing trees that will be kept alongside the road, I don't think that the light fixtures are going to be a major design element that's going to give a lot of character or even add character to the subdivision. I would like to talk a little bit about the flowage easement situation that we talked about last time, if you recall, and Maureen talks a bit about it in her memo. When we first started to talk about the drainage plan for the area around Sawyer Road, there's a drainage area in through here that ultimately drained down in this direction and came down to a point. Initially, we had a fairly large detention basin there. That was going to be disturbing about an acre of wetland. In reviewing it in the site walk with DEP and the Corps of Engineers, we felt that there were better ways to handle it. After Les Berry had done the calculations, he found that the amount of water, if we didn't detain it, that would flow off the site down across four property owners would be increased somewhat, but not to a point where it would cause anybody any concern. The Corps of Engineers was not concerned about the additional flow, the DEP wasn't, as long as we were able to get flow easements. We made some attempt and were successful in getting several of the flow easements. However, we were not successful in gaining one easement from the Rod and Gun Club. What that meant, though, is that we had to go back and look at other ways to handle stormwater leaving the property. And according to the DEP, we had to do so in such a way that it met some of their minimum guidelines. They didn't demand that we keep this down to a zero discharge or zero increase in runoff. They would allow a slight increase in runoff. Les Berry went back and recalculated some of his calculations and ways of looking at the way stormwater travels through here. We went back and looked at ways that we could introduce a detention basin. The plan that we have right now, and I believe that Maureen has a copy of this. Everybody has a copy of this? Okay. Is to install a small detention basin right here. This is between...
Excuse me, Mr. Dewan, could you either move the podium or move the board, because I can't see what you're talking about? Perhaps if you could move the...
The podium is legally moved, Terry, I don't think.
Or if you could just, where you're pointing with your light, that's great. Thank you very much. That's much better. Thank you.
Depends on where you're sitting.
Well, I spoke up first.
You all see this area down here?
I can. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, this is several hundred feet just south of Sawyer Road. And here's the Chesterwood Trail, that arc road that comes through here. This diagram right here, which I'll pin up, is an enlargement of this area right here. This detention basin, which is about 5,000 square feet, is going to be located in a small area of wetland that extends into that space between lots 71 and 72. This is really one of the only places where we have to excavate wetland as part of the project other than for road construction. It did mean, however, that we had to go back to the DEP and the Corps of Engineers. We made an application to the Corps. They reviewed it last week. We got notification on Friday from Jay Clements of the Corps' office in Augusta that they approved the application. It means another 0.11 acres of wetland will be affected by the development of the project. We are looking upon this as a temporary impact, meaning that when the wetland is disturbed, we will take the soil that's on the base of the wetland right now, scrape it off to one side, probably stockpile it temporarily on the road base, excavate down the 4 or 5 feet to build the detention basin. Once that's in place and properly graded, we'll then take the stockpile of wetland soil and put it back where it came from, albeit a little bit lower, and hopefully then with proper care, the wetland vegetation that is now in seed form will once again sprout up and will once again have a wetland situation there. It will not be a wet pond. Water will still allow to flow through it. And we envision that it's going to still function as a wetland. It does involve, though, another tenth of an acre of wetlands. And so our application to the Corps was changed from 1.43 acres of wetland alteration to 1.54 acres of wetland alteration. We've had to do the same thing with the DEP process. We've made a formal application for project modification that went in, is now being reviewed by the DEP. And we've had a meeting with Mary Beth Richardson, who is the project reviewer at the Portland office of DEP. We've also met with Ross Cutlitz from Soil Conservation Service. Together, we and Les Berry, we all worked out the details of how this would be constructed, how the pipes would fit in, the erosion control measures that would be taken, this reuse of the topsoil that I mentioned earlier, and we're all in agreement that that's the proper way to handle the stormwater that comes off of this part of the project to avoid the increase of stormwater leaving the site down onto the Rod and Gun Club property. So that is pretty much what's happening down there. We talked a little bit about the conservation easement. That was an issue that was raised, as you know, by the town manager. We did make the appearance before the Conservation Commission, and at that meeting there were three representatives of the Land Trust. We went over the deed of conservation easement, which you have a copy of, all 9 pages of it, in great detail that night. The only changes that you're probably going to be seeing in the final copy were two. One related to the use of snowmobiles that would be used only to drag cross-country ski grooming equipment in case that ever became a form of recreation for use of the common open space that runs through the property. One of the things that we called for in the conservation easement was a prohibition on motorized vehicles using the common open space, and specifically called out snowmobiles. And someone, I think with a great deal of foresight, said, well, what happens if the town or somebody ever got to the point of establishing groomed trails and you needed to have a motorized vehicle like a snowmobile come out there with tracking equipment? And so that will be added to it. There was also a comment made relative to the use of chemical herbicides, pesticides, fungicides, fertilizers, and so forth. And we're going to be strengthening that to make sure that anybody that has to use those type of chemicals is a licensed applicator. John Green from the Conservation Commission is here tonight. There's also a representative from the Land Trust that can add any further thoughts about that particular document. So, I think that's about all that we've done. The tree planting plan. How could I forget that?
How could you forget that?
How could I forget it? I forgot it because I somehow left my copy of my letter back at my desk. So, you have before you a revised set of planting plans. We also took a look at all the plants that were proposed as part of the overall landscaping plan that were on those four or five pages. We took your comments to heart. I think we've done a lot of simplification. We've took out a lot of what some people might call exotic species. Things, at least by their name alone, sounded like they were exotic. And the only time we use things like fringe trees are for accents along the roadway. We have greatly simplified the planting plan. Most of the trees along the major road, Dominicus Crossing, will be red oaks. In other places where we travel through wetlands or through the power lines, we're changing the species. We anticipate having a lot of existing trees remain throughout the length of the project. Most of those will probably be red oaks because that's the dominant tree that's out there right now. We are calling for three or four other types of trees, but in character, though, the red oaks will form the basis for this ultimate canopied effect that we anticipate having probably in a mere 20 or 30 years after this is all done. On other parts of the project, for example, in Alicia Circle, we've identified on the planting plan a group of four or five types of hardwood trees that we feel would be suitable as street trees. It's our intent to allow people who are moving into that neighborhood to draw upon that list that we're showing on the planting plan and to be able to plant a tree of their choice from that very specific list in front of their house in the locations that are shown on the planting plan. There'll be some adjustment, of course. If someone wants to move a tree over 5 feet, that's going to be perfectly all right. But we don't want people to plant a willow tree, for example, in an area that we've designated as the linden tree. And I think that by taking all these steps, we'll have a much more unified approach to the landscaping for the subdivision. In areas of major importance at intersections, for example, or by the common green, we've taken more care in looking at the varieties of trees, and probably you're treating that with a much more unified appearance. For example, around the common green, all those are red oaks with a line of maples along the back side. We would have liked to use a lot more maples. They're not particularly salt tolerant, and we are concerned that whatever we plant out there is still going to be around in the 20 or 30 years that we're anticipating the canopy to need to take effect. So, I think those are some of the major things that we've changed since the last time. Borrow somebody's a copy of my letter that I handed in. Do you have an extra copy of that?
I think we could probably.
We also gave you a revised copy of the boundary survey. A lot of the so-called historical data was taken off by Steve Ross in an attempt to make it a lot more legible.
Okay.
We do bring up the question of sidewalks, and we only bring it up for a point of discussion. I realize that the ordinance does not allow the planning board any latitude, but there are three locations on Tomas Road, Chesterwood Trail, and Arabella Drive, where it would seem like if sidewalks were not created, not built, that the project would still be as strong without them. And we would like to have a discussion on that at some point this evening. So that's...
Thank you, Mr. DeWan. Do any of the planning board members have any questions for the applicant? Mr. Carlson.
Yes, it was brought up earlier in the public part of the meeting here tonight, and also there's a letter here from Mr. Woodward at Wood on Wells Road. And I said way, way back, I was concerned about the stress on Wells Road and the phasing of the project. It seemed to have, you know, disappeared. We thought about it. We discussed it. But I really think that that road from Sawyer to Wells should be constructed at a very early date to provide continuity for the project, double access, and also, again, the stress on Wells Road. Sawyer Road is not as congested as Wells Road is. The opportunity for construction materials, equipment to come through on Sawyer Road, I think far outweighs the use of that exit and entrance on Wells. So I hope you would consider, the board would even consider, make it a contention or what we should do is get that road through. And I don't know what your response to that is right now. I'm not saying it should be a paved road all the way through with all the water to be being taken care of, but as far as the accessibility to the project. Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Sure.
I would go a step further. Not only would I support that, I agree it doesn't have to be certainly a finished road, but it needs to be, in my view, a road that provides full construction access so that the project is accessible from both of those roads. And I would go so far as to say I view that as a phasing prerequisite, which I believe is within the purview of this board.
Thank you, Mr. Azalina. Do any other board members have any questions or comments? Mr. DeWan, do you want to respond to any of the comments that have been made so far?
Well, I guess the phasing issue is probably going to boil down to one that we're going to have to talk over with both Peter and Juan, Dominica's Crossing. Obviously, there are cost implications involved with it. As you know, we've been working with Susie on a plan that will provide a very large amount of buffering between our construction activity and the back of her property. I don't know if Mr. Azalina was aware of all that. I didn't talk about any detail, but on this plan here, and probably as part of packages that were submitted earlier, we describe in great detail additional planting that will be built back of Susie's property and on our property. An earth berm will be created, a fence that will be built to provide her with a visual buffer and a very substantial amount of new plantings just for that very reason, to preserve her privacy so she'll be minimally aware of construction traffic as it goes back there. Granted, it's not enough to hide or everything that is going to go on there and to block every bit of noise that comes through there, but I think we've gone to a great extent to listen to her, to work with her, even to the point of developing a landscape plan for her property and for our property, that will take that into consideration.
Mr. Carlson.
I just want to respond to that. My comments were not because of that individual property owner. I'm thinking of the project as in its entirety, working, bringing in equipment. Now, if you're building 10, 15 homes, never at one time possibly, but five or six, there's a lot of equipment, and what we got here is a funnel effect. Everything must come through Wells Road, must come through the big intersection down there on Spurwink. That's going to be probably the main intersection, and that's everything's going to go in and out of there. Cement trucks, front-end loaders and what have you, bus carpenters and plumbers and electricians. And I would think that it would be a good idea for you folks even to minimize this congestion of traffic and traffic flow by opening up another area, again, not in a paved highway, not with the, but just enough to bring in the equipment. And I just think it makes sense. And I think it would, and I don't see the big expense in that. I don't see where that's going to hurt you folks as far as the bottom line is concerned.
Money's going to have to be spent at some point. Question of timing and...
That's correct. Yeah. But it's a big project.
Yeah.
So money has to be spent. And you can't just say, well, we'll chew away at it and finally we'll get to this other entrance that's coming in off Sawyer.
In terms of putting utilities in, I suppose it doesn't make sense of, you know, to build the road first because you have to come back then at some other point then to put in sewer line and water line. I guess that's a concern that we've had all along. If you're going to do it, you got to do it right and only do it once. So it's not simply a matter of putting in, you know, a temporary gravel road. It means, you know, doing all the work, all the ledge excavation and so forth.
Will the entrance on Wells Road also be a fully constructed road before you do any building in there? In other words, would it be fully paved and power put in and everything on that entrance from off Wells Road?
We'll be putting the entrance road in. I would assume that the house construction will start while the road is in rough graded form.
So why can't the road be in the same form off Sawyer?
Because we'll be putting in the infrastructure along Wells Road at the same time we're doing that.
The road, I understand what you're saying. I think
you
Peter Anastas and Lonis would be the builder on the project. I think, Roy, the best thing, and I think Susie mentioned this at one point, is why do that first phase, Lorenzo Lane, make that phase two? Come back to that, make that phase four. The road is just too long to do at once. I don't think you'd find I think Chimbro would have a hard time doing that, posting the bond for that, but to do it in phases, one, to get through, because don't forget we've agreed to do quite a bit of work on bringing sewers up, grinding, and repaving a road out, you know, on Wells or whatever. So probably the best solution would be to, like you say, go straight through, but it still realistically has to be in phases. Otherwise, you'd be building a road, I would guess, well over a mile long. It'd really be... I think asking a bit much, but I think what we could do is abandon Lorenzo Lane and come back to that afterwards. So go straight through, go one, two, three, as quickly as possible, and then do it that way.
Well, you understand what I'm trying to. I'm not in the business that you're in, of course, but I'm just trying to make it as easy for everyone. Not increase the expense of the project to any big degree.
Right. That'd be the quickest way. I think you still have to get three phases to get that length of road in with that many houses. I think what we can offer to do is go back to phase two, if you will. Go one, three, four, so we go straight through to Sawyer and then come back to two.
Phase road up. If you want up to that point right there.
Right. Right.
May I ask, and please explain this to me, are you inferring that you need infrastructure all the way across to complete that road purely for accessibility purposes?
What I mean is you'd be doing it twice if you tried to get...
No, that's not my question.
Right.
I asked about the infrastructure. Right. We're talking about extending that road so that
right.
access from two points, purely for trucks, heavy equipment,
And I don't know your business, I don't purport to know.
I guess that I'm saying is yes, in a way, because what you're asking us to do is build a road year-round that's substantial enough to carry heavy trucks carrying heavy loads, and then we'll have to dig the same road up. Not only that, we have to push the road through a mile. Yes, I think that's, you're asking us to do a lot, you're greatly, vastly increasing the expense or feasibility of doing the project.
Could you help me with this? What do you have to do twice?
Lay the gravel, make it substantial enough so that it would could hold those heavy trucks. I tell you, I'd have to check exactly what we had to do, because I've never done it the way you're suggesting we do it. I've never seen it done that way. Build one road, build it so as a temporary access road, and then come back, dig it up again, and then put in your utilities and finish it off.
So the cost issue, and I recognize there is some.
Right.
The cost issue is undetermined at this point. I mean, whether it's a lot or a little, we don't know that.
Well, I'd say okay. I think it's pretty obvious
it'd
be a lot.
Words in your mouth.
Yeah, sure.
Asking a question.
Yeah, I'd say it'd be a lot just because you're building. To me, you're building a road. You just have to dig up, but. Albeit it'd be a temporary as much as you could, but you still have to carry heavy, heavy equipment over that.
Can I ask, and this is for anybody who wants to answer the question, second part of the question. If I remember, Sawyer comes out on Route 77, and when it exits in Route 77, it's in Scarborough. If I remember boundaries, are we still in Cape Elizabeth at that point?
Yeah.
We are? Right. Is there a possibility, another possibility to consider, maybe routing traffic such that it minimizes the impact on those intersections, either at Wells and Spurwink or off Spurwink and 77, et cetera? That may be a consideration that would also help.
You mean construction traffic?
Yes, construction traffic. That's why I was suggesting that my recollection was Sawyer came out in Scarborough, but obviously I'm wrong.
Right. I guess I'm losing. Once it goes all the way through, I can.
No. I'm sorry. I was suggesting in lieu of the
right.
My concern is that there is a tremendous amount of traffic. There is only one access point. Mm-hmm. To that project. I'm sure the project will be completed, but if there are any problems in the future, we have an access point in there and a problem and a road not completed. Mm-hmm. But a possible compromise with that is that if traffic into the project were better controlled, that could also help. Remember, right now, everything logically is going to come in. It'll come in off Sawyer and and onto Wells, or off Spurwink and onto Wells.
Right.
And that's it. That's the only point. Maybe there is some other alternative, other than putting the road all the way through. I leave it to you. I don't know what that is.
Okay. I mean, we can work on that. I thought the main goal was to try to push the road through.
I was just trying to suggest an alternative.
Okay.
Yeah, and this has been reviewed, of course, by DEP for traffic impacts. It's being reviewed right now by TYLN. Steve Bradstreet's looking at it, and traffic is one of the concerns that they're looking at. And this has not been raised as an issue so far by either one of the technical reviewers. But we will look at that and come back, hopefully for the final time in April.
Well, you do remind me that I suspected that you might be looking for a final time in April. So
we'd like to get out of your hair at some point.
I understand that as a reasonable expectation. I'd like to just state that we do have a letter from TYLN in our package dated March the 11th. I take it that you are taking each of those suggestions to heart, and those will be reflected on the final plans.
We have also given TYLN a copy of the revised plan that we talked about before. There is also a a blue book full of drainage calculations with Steve Bradstreet and Russ Cutlitzer are looking at right now.
Okay. Maureen has reminded me that Tom Emery is unable to be here this evening, but apparently has given Maureen some comments. You would expect nothing less from Mr. Emery.
I was disappointed not to see him tonight.
Without further ado, would you advise us of what Tom's comments might be?
Certainly. Tom is at another planning board evening this evening. So, his concern continues to be with the prototypes for the actual buildings and how they're going to fit and the massing on the lots. And he is continuing to ask for a sketch, and what he's looking for, and I'm paraphrasing, is a perspective sketch where you can look down the street. Perhaps you could structure this by taking a photograph of the road and using some typical images that you already have available and overlay them. He hasn't seen what you've presented this evening. You may want to just leave that here, and I can arrange for him to look at that instead. His concern was that that the notion of cluster zoning is unique and that he's hoping that there's going to be some sensitivity to creating some private yards. And he'd like to see a depiction that shows him that the houses aren't going to be too big for the lots. And he pointed out that that was an issue raised by other board members in the past. And he pointed that out as addressing a concern which he calls apparent density versus the overall density for the project.
Thank you, Maureen.
That's it.
Mr. DeWan, there are also the items that are mentioned in the town planner's memorandum to us, and you didn't mention any of those in particular, but I, for one, and I suspect other board members would be expecting that those would be attended to. No.
I think we've touched on most of those. Maybe if we just go down, this is the letter from the planner dated March 18th.
Mm-hmm.
Subdivision review A, plans with the comprehensive plan. I don't think there's anything additional to add there. Road design, again, I think that is pretty well set. I would like to have comments, though, on the landscaping plan, item C. As you know, we did go to great lengths to, I think, improve the planting plan. The off-street areas, we really have not changed anything there. The road layout has not changed. Access to sunlight issues, I don't think have ever been an issue. This whole question, though, regarding bulk and massing on these lots, I think is illustrated in the top illustration here. And I would like to hear your comments, and I would like to hear Tom's comments when he's had a chance to look at this. Block length, I don't believe, is an issue. I talked a little bit about the installation of granite column marker posts to identify neighborhoods. We had submitted a typical detail of that early on in the process, and that line of thinking has not really changed. The road names have not changed. Stormwater issues, as you know now, are changed somewhat. The application to the Corps of Engineers on the DEP has been supplied to Maureen, and I believe you have a copy of that information. Pedestrian easements, that has not changed. The number of trails, the location of trails, the crossings, and so forth has been all discussed with the Conservation Commission. We had an excellent meeting with them the other night. Lot areas have not changed. The final subdivision plat for lot 71 and 72 will have to change because we are adding a little bit more common open space that will drain water into this detention basin here that has not affected the buildable area of either of these two lots, however. Vehicular access on top of page 4. Maureen makes the comments that vehicular access to the western building envelope of lot 22 appears problematic. We really haven't changed that at all since the last time. This is lot 22 right here. The western portion is this area up on top here. We still intend to provide access down to this lot off of Lisa Circle. This is the driveway that crosses over the detention basins. It would be landscaped as shown on the plan, and we feel it's certainly an adequate way to get a vehicle back there.
So, Mr. Dewan, on that point, I don't know what Ms. Tarian's proper name is now, but she was indicating that she would be concerned if there were a driveway from Lot 22 onto Wells Road. Is that being proposed at this point?
We're showing a driveway that comes in off of Alicia Circle right here. It's possible to have a driveway. Yeah, the intention is to have the driveway come off of Alicia Circle. I think that we made the point last time that when we went out there on that sidewalk that Saturday, it seemed to be possible to have a driveway up on the corner of the property there, given a certain amount of clearing and removal of underbrush but for one house if we were to be located there. But the intent is to have the driveway coming off of Alicia Circle. Another point under L, and I think that probably needs some clarifications. The planner's report talks about wetlands relative to driveways. There were several lots identified during the preliminary review where driveway construction might include wetland alterations. If these driveway locations were confirmed at this time, the permit issued as part of this approval could apply to these driveways. This all has been done. The calculations that we did for wetland alterations included an assumption that the driveways would be built in the locations that were shown on those specific lots where wetlands had to be crossed to get to the housing site. And so that's been done. It's all been approved by the Corps. And we don't feel that the future lot owners are going to have to do anything additional in terms of applying for wetland alteration permits to construct driveways, because that's already been shown on the site plan.
Through the chair. Mm-hmm. The issue I had was that the note, unless you've changed the note, the note that I saw on the plan said typical driveway locations. There's nothing on the plan that says this is the place you have to put the driveway. If you move it to another location, then you need to do something different. And I just think that needs to be clear on the plan so that when individual lot owners are buying the lots, they know that they have to stick to those driveway locations or seek approvals, additional approvals from the planning board.
We should probably do that, just cross-hatch those areas that have already been permitted by DEP and by the Corps.
Either that or a list of the lot numbers where the driveways are fixed and just add that as a note to one of the plans.
Okay. Multiplex and cluster housing, that really has not changed at all. Sidewalks, I did bring up the discussion point. Maureen points out that sidewalks shall be required on one side of the road, and that requirement shall not be waived by the planning board. The comment was made that we may also want to consider looking at crosswalk for all four corners where Dominic's Crossing, Lorenzo Lane, and Alicia Circle all intersect, and that's this point right here. I suppose that could be done. I think the consideration here that this is not a high traffic area. We don't expect to see a lot of crossing take place at this point, and we'd hate to see it become very urbanized, but if it's the wish of the board, we could certainly do that. Natural features, we've talked about the land trust involvement and the DEP involvement in the conservation easement, the 100 acres of preserved open space, including the wetlands, et cetera, has not been changed to any radical extent. We will have a little bit more common open space as a result of this modification here, but it's just going to be a matter of a tenth or two of an acre.
Mr. Dewan, on the natural features and the dedication to the town, I remember, I think some months ago, a letter from the town manager concerned about the interplay between the town and the land trust. Is that all worked out now?
That's the reason that we, using his advice, we went to see the Conservation Commission. And he said he will advise the council to take their lead from the Conservation Commission. And as a result of that letter, In our response to it, we had the meeting with the Conservation Commission and the Land Trust to review all the details of how that interchange will work.
That's the Conservation Commission and the Land Trust, but then is the town council?
The next step is to appear before the town council, and I haven't...
Which you have to do soon, and so...
Yeah, I don't know if you know when we're scheduled again. We've asked to be on the March 24th meeting.
I will await further developments.
On top of page five, under scenic vistas and view corridors, we are not really changing anything that we've been talking about all along. We are not located in a scenic vista or scenic area. We feel this will be a scenic area after it's developed because of the quality of the homes that will be built here. We have provided for a limited building envelope to make sure that the view from the town green is not affected by a construction of a house on Lot 20. We have provided architectural drawings for the proposed affordable housing that will be built throughout the development. We have provided covenants in Exhibit A that applies to Phase 1, the architectural and the siting controls that are being applied to the development. Open space impact fee has not changed since our preliminary application. The common open space under R will be dedicated or deeded to the town. Sewage disposal, all will be public sewer except for that one lot on Lot 63 on Sawyer Road. Flood hazards, we are not in a floodplain. The wetland report, we've provided the town with a great deal of information on individual wetland alterations. We've talked about tonight how because of this project right here, we'll be increasing the amount of wetland disturbance from 1.43 to 1.54 acres of wetland fill. As part of the plan before the DEP and the Corps of Engineers, we are dedicating a sizable part of the property, 35 acres of the land, as part of the conservation easement. That's being used as our compensation package to offset the loss of the acre and a half of wetland. The DEP normally would require an 8-to-1 ratio. If you lose an acre and a half of wetland, we should have had to set aside as preserved wetlands about 12 acres of land. We're setting aside 35 acres, about three times what the state would require as an absolute minimum. And we are doing a number of other things in the siting of the subdivision to try and minimize the wetland impacts. Wetlands really were not an issue because we dealt with the DEP and the Corps of Engineers throughout the planning process. We showed them the steps that we took to minimize wetlands. We took their advice in many, many locations to try and minimize wetland impacts. Wildlife habitats, really no significant habitats identified. Maureen points out that the proposed open space may be preserved, that will be preserved, may serve as a wildlife corridor, ultimately leading down to Spurwink Marsh. Letter W, numbering of units. This was a new one on us. The applicant may want to add a note that each plant shall have a clearly visible number. I don't know if that's a typical planning board request or is that a public safety concern, but I don't see any problem with doing that. Utilities, we do have letters from the water district. We have verified the construction debris will not be taken to the transfer station, will be disposed of on site or privately as appropriate. That was a concern that DEP had raised, and it's part of our application with the state. And finally, we do have evidence of financial and technical capability.
When was that submitted, Mr. DeMond? Is that from a year and a half ago, or is it more recent?
To the DEP, it was submitted about a year ago. Yeah. Last summertime, we have our DEP approval. Approved was February 14th by the DEP.
But I'm talking about in terms of financial capability as well as technical capability. I take it there have been no adverse changes since the application was made?
As far as I know. At least not since February 14th when it was approved by DEP. The other issues that has been raised, the phasing, performance guarantee, and wetland alteration permit. As you heard Peter say, we will discuss the phasing plan, and what I would like to do is to meet with Maureen and the town manager ahead of time, so when we come back before you in April, April 14th, I believe, or 15th, we should have a plan which, at least from the town staff concerns, meets the concerns that we heard tonight by members of the planning board. Performance guarantees, we have asked a number of local contractors to provide us with preliminary opinions of costs for the construction of all the infrastructure related to the project, and that will be used as part of the draft of the performance guarantee. And finally, the wetlands alteration permit.
Will we see the form of the performance guarantee, though? You intend to submit that in the package the next time around?
I believe that will be ready by that point.
That would be an important document.
Yeah, we've already gotten a couple numbers back from two contractors. We've asked, I think, four contractors for prices at this point.
But I'm talking about the form of the guarantee, though, in addition to the amount.
Yes. Okay, the wetland alteration permit, that's there before you. I've talked about the changes that have been made to that. So, would rather not go over all the comments that Steve Bradstreet has made in his review letter of March 11th.
He's and we would quite, rather have you not go through.
I would rather not have to either. He does raise some excellent points. Les Berry and BH2M are reviewing all these comments right now, and these will all be submitted back to Steve and in due time, in time for a review, and then to get back to Maureen in time for the April meeting.
Okay, time is that the package date for the 15th would be
the end of the month, so it's, I think it's
coming up fast. Yeah. So you've really got about 10 days.
Yes,
you're well aware
of that.
I was going to say you're well aware of how the system works here.
Yes.
So.
And we do appreciate the timeliness of the review. Okay. You did a great job in going through a lot of detail.
Well, you've certainly given us a lot to contemplate tonight. Are there any further comments or questions from the board?
Madam?
Yes, Steve.
Following up Tom Emery's comments from tonight and my comments from a previous meeting, the phase one housing prototypes, the plan that was included in the package tonight, the fold-out sheet, I, for one board member, would like to see, since we've gone to this trouble to do the street scene here, streetscape, I'd like to see a plan that reflected those houses on these lots, because they're not the same houses that are on here. And I would also like to see full measurements, setbacks, size of the houses, square footage of the houses, and how big the garages are. And stuff. If you scale it off using a really rude scale, some of these things are as close as 35 feet. Each other. I think, and I'd like to have all the measurements on there that can be on there so everyone can really see how big the houses are going to be on the lots. And the other comment I have is regarding the open space that's going to be conveyed to the whomever, Conservation Commissioner or whatever. Is there a particular reason why that can't be done up front? Does it have to be done while the project phases are being opened up? Seen would be more of a
well, we'll be building trails and bridges and the other improvements. We'd like to do those in phases, and that was part of the plan that we submitted as part of preliminary approval. It just seemed logical to have that open space go along with the phase that was being developed at that time.
Is there a reason why it couldn't be conveyed and have the trails built as the project as then progresses? Would that cause a problem as far as the developer working on town-owned land or Conservation Commission-owned land? I don't know.
I don't know.
It just, someone brought up in one of the things we found on the podium tonight that if project gets full approval and the project is flipped to someone, and I'm not saying that's going to happen, but it could happen, then the good intentions of building trails, et cetera, may not happen as we had anticipated. Or maybe the conveyance of the open land may, someone may come back with a change to the subdivision plan. And I just think it would be a nice thing for the town to get the open space sort of up front. Just a thought for discussion. That's it for me.
Any other comments, Mr. Carlson?
One final argument for the double access. Again, Peter, on the two roads coming in. If you were, as you develop the Wells Road entrance, you develop the housing in there, I would think you'd want to reduce truck traffic in there because there are people living there, and it's noisy, and it's children, whatever, that you'd want to have another entrance to as you add on to the back of that development. I'm just giving that as a potential, you know, not as a potential buyer, but as a person here, kind of aware of what you look at when you buy a place. You look at a house and the traffic and what have you. So as you advance out, you'd work from the back, more or less, and bringing in these various vehicles. And also, I would think it would also be a lot kinder to the road that you're developing on the entrance to Wells. That's supposed to be quite a nice entrance, as I recall. And if you're going to continually run traffic in there as you expand and mushroom out, I think it would be a good idea if you could provide some other entrance. I don't want to belate this anymore.
No, all I'm saying is the point's well taken, and I agree with you on that, Roy. And the same point that Ron made about rerouting the traffic and then checking on the price of pushing the road through anyway, I'll have all that. Okay, I'll do that with Terry in the next few days.
Excellent. I do note that it's almost 8:20, and we do have another substantive item on the agenda. I'm not trying to close things out prematurely, but I would ask the board members to bring this part of the discussion to a close so that we can get on with it. But having said that, Mr. Asselin.
Yeah, I won't belabor it. I just want to just clarify, and I'll try and make it quick, on the traffic accessibility is exactly what I was talking about, that the two concerns I have is that the through road ultimately gets done, and maybe that's covered under the performance guarantee, I don't know, but in the development phase of the project, the alternative I was suggesting is if there is another access, it doesn't have to be necessarily all the way through, just that there is a second one that precludes one ingress, one egress, both off Route 77 and off Wells Road. It's 200 some acres. Maybe there's another way to do that. I don't know. That's what I was suggesting.
Thank you, Mr. Asselina. Any other comments from any board members or questions? Mr. Wilcox.
I think exploring some form of gravel road access is interesting, but I would sort of caution that we probably wouldn't want to see a lot of erosion and dirt flying around for a few years either. So in looking at that, I would assume that the applicant would take a look at appropriate erosion control and temporary mulching and seeding and the sorts of things that would need to go along with that, because I don't think anybody would want to go out there and see lots of mud for a few years.
That's all covered as part of our DEP permit for construction phasing.
Right.
All right, Mr. DeWan, any other further questions, comments from the board members? All right, I understand that you're going to be taking the comments that are made tonight seriously, going to be responding to the items that are set forth in Maureen's memo and also the PY Len memo and the further development in terms of stormwater management. We've got some specific issues with respect to phasing and road construction, it sounds like, and also the not mock-ups, but certainly proposals for housing corridors and placement of buildings on particular lots. And it sounds like we will look forward to seeing your return next next month. Do I have, do I hear a motion for the board to consider, Mr. Parkhurst?
Motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Dominicus Crossing Limited Liability Company for Dominicus Crossing, 97 lot plus one multifamily unit subdivision located on Wells Road and Sawyer Road, be tabled to the regular April 15th, 1997 meeting of the planning board.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. Thank you. Unanimous?
We'd like to take this and copy it and then give it back to you, or we could deliver it directly to Tom.
Thank you. That would be acceptable. Either way.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
More than you wanted, right? Uh-huh.
While we're waiting for the changeover from one project to another, let me state for the record that there were two items on the podium when we arrived this evening, neither of which I mentioned in my introductory remarks. One is a letter to the Planning Board dated March the 18th, 1997, regarding Dominicus Crossing comments from Mark Woodward. And the second item is a memorandum dated March the 17th, 1997, to the Planning Board from the Conservation Commission, again regarding Dominicus Crossing and also the Plummer Wetland Boundary. The next and final item on the agenda this evening is the Purputuk Drive public access waiver. Excuse me, a request by Fitzpatrick Associates for a public access waiver to create two lots, U-27 and 28, located off Purputuk Drive under section 19-4-2B, public access waiver. Ms. Gilbert.
Thank you. My name is Nancy Gilbert. I'm with Sebago Technics, and I'm here tonight with Joel and Kelly Fitzpatrick to present to you our proposal for a public access waiver to create two new lots off of the existing Purputuk Drive. We came and presented in a workshop session to you folks a few months ago this plan, which showed an approximately 350-foot extension of the existing Purputuk Drive located off Spurwink Avenue. Currently, Purputuk Drive provides access to two homes that have been there for several decades. Our proposal is to add two new house lots to that area and to extend the road approximately 350 feet. The road would end in a hammerhead and would be providing a common access drive to the two lots. The plan that you see before you shows a conceptual layout of how the homes might be situated on the pieces of property. Since the last time that we met with you, we have done some additional work and have had the project reviewed by your engineer, Ost Associates. They prepared some comments for us, and we had originally intended to be on your agenda last month. However, in response to some of their comments, we asked to be continued to this month's meeting. In your packets, we have provided comment and response to the OST letter. One of the primary things that affected the plan was that there was a drainage way, and I'll just point to it over here, which crosses through the field area on the property. When Mark Hampton of our office visited the site, he did not classify that drainage way as a stream. When Mr. Harding of Ost Associates visited the site this winter, he asked Will Cook of the DEP to join him on the site to help him with the classification of whether that might be considered a stream. Mr. Cook did determine that he felt it should be classified as a stream, and the reasons behind that is my understanding is that apparently there's a stream upstream of the site and then also downstream of the site, and so that perhaps historically the area, although may not now be considered as a stream, might have at one time been historically a stream. So Mr. Cook asked that we evaluate whether we could adjust our extension of the roadway to meet the permit by rule criteria for avoidance in that area. As a result, we did shift the road. You can see that it has shifted slightly to the east, and we've provided an easement for that roadway across the frontage of lots 1 and 2. That maintains the setback criteria in accordance with the permit by rule criteria. You'll see in your packets that we have prepared a permit by rule application form. That's basically a one-way type process with the DEP in which you complete the application form, and if you are not contacted within a period of 2 weeks, then you are considered approved. So we do have that as part of the packet. There were some other comments that were made by Ost Associates regarding some details on drainage culvert sizing, radii, etc. As far as the culvert sizing goes, we supplied some additional information as requested by Ost Associates, and their final comment was that they would like to see that the proposed culvert, which is here, and there's also a secondary culvert here, that the material be a smooth wall interior to increase the flow capacity of those, and that's certainly acceptable to us. We would suspect that the material might be such as a polyethylene material in which it's smooth bore on the inside and corrugated on the outside, a plastic material. So that is certainly something that we would be willing to comply with no problem. Mr. Harding had commented regarding some of the criteria in the ordinance for radiuses and access along the existing road and our proposed extension. Mr. McGoldrick has supplied a letter, which I believe you folks also have, indicating his acceptance of the proposed.
Excuse me, Ms. Gilbert, I'm having a hard time listening to you. Billy, would you be nice enough to ask those people to quiet down back there? It's I think I must be picking up something. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Mr. McGoldrick, I believe, has submitted a letter to you folks indicating his acceptance of the proposed layout and maneuverability for the fire protection equipment. One of the issues that was raised by Mr. Harding was site distance at the existing intersection of Papudic Drive. As you know, we are proposing an extension of Papudic Drive, and that the existing portion of it has been in existence for several decades. We visited the site to evaluate what might be available for site distance at that location, and looking southerly along Spurwink Road, Spurwink Avenue, everything is fine and exceeds the 350-foot criteria. As you look northerly along Spurwink Avenue, there are some existing mature trees and a utility pole which prevents the 350-foot available site distance at the location identified in the ordinance. It's my understanding that there are options for flexibility with that, and that there is a location which you can pull slightly closer to Spurwink Avenue, in which you can see through the fixed obstacles. In follow-up to that, Ost Associates also went out and did their own survey and evaluation of that, and they concur with that finding. As a follow-up to that, Joel Fitzpatrick had asked the police department to provide any accident data that might be available on the history of that intersection. And according to the police department records, there was one accident in 1988, which I don't believe was at the intersection, but just along that stretch of road, and it was due to icy conditions along the roadway. So we're confident that there is a sufficient latitude to allow this existing condition to remain as it is, given the fact that there are well-established trees in the area, which we'd like not to have to affect, and also there's a utility pole there. I reviewed the packet that Maureen has prepared for you folks, and I would just like to address there are a series of conditions that Maureen has suggested, and I'd like to just sort of highlight them. The first one is with regard to the HHE 200 forms, which were submitted as part of the application. Both of the lots are proposing subsurface disposal systems, and the plumbing inspector had indicated that five test pits are actually required within each of the systems for a completed HHE 200 to comply with the local ordinance criteria. He'd also highlighted that the proposed systems and the HHE 200s are in accordance with the state criteria, but that the municipality does have some extra requirements on that. We would like to be able to cooperate with the staff on that and provide the additional test pit information sufficient for those systems. And we do understand that if it's not acceptable with the town staff, then we would have to find an alternative location for that. But we are willing and apologize for the oversight and the missing of the additional test pits. The second item is that the 24-inch culvert be installed with a smooth wall pipe. That's what we just discussed. That's certainly acceptable. That the declaration of the road easement and maintenance agreement be revised to delete the last sentence, section 3, page 2. I believe that allows some latitude to modify the roadway without planning board approval, and that's certainly not something that we had intended to have in there, and would be willing to comply with that. That the deeds for the lot include binding covenants that access for the lot shall be in compliance with the planning board approved plans. Certainly, again, that's something we'd certainly be willing to comply with. And that the final condition would be that there be no alteration to the site nor a building permit issued until the above conditions were met. And again, that's something we'd certainly be willing to comply with. If there are any questions, if there's anything else that you would like to ask us, I'm certainly here to answer.
Thank you very much. Any comments or questions from the board? Mr. Azzolino.
What alternatives have you considered to enable you to comply with the 350 feet site distance requirement?
Basically, it's just there's a point at which in the ordinance it cites, I think it's 26 feet back from the center line of the roadway is the point at which you measure it. But if you were allowed to come slightly forward of that, then you can see between the trees are about this big around and there are no limbs on them, and you've got a utility pole about the same size. So it's just a matter of situating yourself properly to do that.
The engineer suggested that the possibility of getting CMP or whoever's utility pole it is moved,
I think,
and possibly improving those sight lines, has that been considered?
I think it's number one, it's a combination of the utility pole and the trees, and the trees are a nice feature that, since there has been no historic problem on this intersection, and this intersection has existed for the number of years that it has, it would be a shame to take down the trees. With regard to the utility pole, Fitzpatrick Associates has made some initial contacts with the utility company to see what the possibility of that might be.
But we don't know what the response is at this point.
You get a response back?
I am going to be meeting with the utility company next week, and they have moved them before in the past for me, for these, not this type of situation, but other situations. So I don't think it'll be a problem, but we are working on that.
Okay. Mr. Azalina, did you have anything further you wanted to mention at this point?
No.
Any other questions or comments? Mr. Wilcox?
I have a question about the, to the west of the new access road, there's a, an area depicted as wetlands.
Yes.
In the center of the thing. Could you tell me a little bit about what the characteristics are here? I noticed that the application before us does not include any wetlands alterations. Are there in fact no buffers associated with this wetland?
That's correct. As one of the items that was also raised in the Yost letter was a question regarding the classification of not only the wetlands on the site, but also the wetlands on adjacent properties. And Mark Hampton of our office went back and revisited the site and did a more detailed soil survey to identify where the wetlands and soil limits were to determine whether there were any setbacks associated with the wetlands. And the drawing that I have below, which you probably can't see down here, but there's a second drawing in your set, and I'm not sure if you have it right there. But that second drawing has been prepared in response to your question. There is a series of Swanton soils which do not carry with them the associated buffer requirements, but there is a small pocket of Whately soils which was identified. Mr. Hampton went out and did a Class A high-intensity soil survey, which identifies soil mapping units down to the closest 1/8 of an acre. There is a small area of Whately soils that are identified, and I can't read that far. It's about 2,300 square feet. And so although there is some soils in that area, it's not of sufficient size to require that it have associated with it the buffering requirements. So there are no buffers that are affecting the lots.
Thank you.
Ms. Gilbert, it's been noticed by me recently that the building envelope for Lot 2 down toward the bottom of the plan that you've submitted, yes, that little tail end down there extends into the wetland.
Yes.
And probably the better thing to do would be to simply revise the edge of the building envelope to cut off any incursion into the wetland.
Yes, and we would certainly agree to that as a condition.
Would you like to explain in 25 words or less this concept of the land to be conveyed to the abutter?
25 or less? I don't think I can do that.
I won't hold you to the 25.
Okay, well, I'll do my best to encapsulate it. This property is not an amendment to the existing subdivision. It is a division of a piece of property that is adjacent to but separate from an existing subdivision. The current landowner of the property is Mr. Rumery. Mr. Rumery owns this lot as well as this lot down here. So we've had quite a bit of discussions with the attorneys involved in the project to make sure that the conveyances, which were arranged as part of the acquisition for the property, do not affect anything regarding an amended subdivision of the adjacent property or the creation of additional lots to require a subdivision on this. And as you all know, the transfer of land to an abutter is not considered as a lot. So it's a rather unique situation in that we have a piece of property at which two pieces are coming off each end, that's about how I can explain it. I don't know. It does not constitute an amended subdivision, and it does not constitute a new subdivision either.
And because of the peculiarities of the way the statute is written, you have to do it in this two-stage process instead of just carving out the particular land that you want to end up in Fitzpatrick Associates.
I'm not so sure is the peculiarity of the standards other than, you know, it provides that piece, the lower piece, Mr. Remery's lower piece, with additional land and allows for the development of the two parcels. And with respect to the upper piece, Mr. Remery lives in that house and had asked that we provide him with just a little bit more of a buffer.
Any other questions from comments from board members? Mr. Azzolino.
Madam Chair, perhaps this is a question for the town planner. Is the applicant requesting a waiver for the site distance?
I believe the applicant's position is that they've met the site distance. Is that correct?
Then I'm confused. Is the town engineer agree with that? As I read the town engineer's, I'm requesting clarification. It's a little unclear to me whether the town engineer agrees or doesn't agree.
Now, the town engineer says that we have found both parties' observations appear to be correct.
I'd like to review the town engineer's comments before I respond to that. The town engineer's position here is, and I'm going to read from his letter, since the 350-foot required site distance cannot be met based on the ordinance's measuring procedure, the applicant should request a waiver of the site distance criteria with the understanding that a site distance of 350 feet can be achieved if the measurement location is moved closer to the Spurwink Avenue center line. The specific thing that that I believe the engineer is saying this applicant cannot meet is that the point from which the measurement should be made is supposed to be 10 feet back from the edge of pavement, and that the site distance can be achieved, but it can be achieved only if you're 6 to 7 feet back from the pavement.
But
so if you have to waive the measuring standard.
Thank you. So you are requesting a waiver for
in,
the...
In that case, we would.
And then that speaks to my second question. Could you enlighten me as to the history of the board's position with respect to waivers of this type?
Maureen.
I'm not aware. In the 6.5 years that I've been watching this, I'm not aware of any time that the board has waived the site distance standard. I just can't think of a time. I do know that about 3 or 4 years ago, you slightly revised the measuring requirement. The measuring requirement you use is a national standard, and the board revised it, council approval, a couple of years ago, so that isolated intermittent interruptions in site distance from a single tree would not be counted against an applicant, and that was done to avoid having to require an applicant to cut down a tree here or there just to meet site distance. And the example I can think of where the board came closest to that standard was a public access waiver on Mitchell Road for 3 lots where the applicant had to basically pull up to Mitchell Road and carefully look through the trees, but the site distance, the actual measurement was achieved. That's the closest I can think of the board coming to this particular requirement.
Wasn't there a problem on Beacon Lane?
Yes, there was a problem on Beacon Lane. In that case, the planning board approved it with the condition that the site distance be achieved.
Oh, that's correct.
And that will be coming back to you.
Well, additional comments, Madam Chair. One is that my concern would, I think that there's a solution. I've seen the site a couple times, and there are existing homes along Spurwink that dump right out onto the street. It's possibly a resolvable problem that I think should be looked into. But my bigger concern would be that, in response to the town planner, that we carefully consider the fact that
if we approve a waiver to that site requirement, that we're setting a precedent that nobody can remember ever doing in the last 7 years. And that's a very tough location in terms of traffic accessibility. So my suggestion to the board would be that it be given some further consideration.
One thing I would like to ask of the board is that if we were starting with a open piece of property in which we were creating an intersection, the site distance criteria certainly would be of more of an issue, in that this site itself, we're simply providing an extension of an existing intersection. It's almost you know, like putting a new road that meets site distance criteria onto an existing road which has, you know, a known issue perhaps with site distance. The site has a long proven track record of not being an issue. And so I'm not sure whether the board can consider that this is simply an extension of a roadway where an established intersection already occurs, and whether there might be some latitude with that.
Absolutely agree with you, Ms. Gilbert. Absolutely agree. But there are only, I mean, I think the traffic history doesn't really say much. There's only two houses on that street, so the fact that there aren't many accidents doesn't say a whole lot. But it isn't the issue of, it's just the, in my view, of the extension of Puputa. It's the issue of the precedent that would concern me.
Thank you, Mr. Azzolino. Following up, though, on what you said, do you want to try to, there were a couple of suggestions about moving signs and that sort of thing. Do you want to, I didn't understand that you've actually agreed to do anything like that.
As Mr. Fitzpatrick indicated, we had contacted the utility company to try to get the pole moved.
Right.
As far as the signage goes, that's a little bit up the street and would be something that would have to be worked out with the town. And as far as the real estate sign goes, I know that was a comment that was in the engineer's letter. That's sort of a moot point. And
is that that's the sign that advertises this particular?
That's right.
So we could make that go away fairly easily?
Yes, you can. And so, you know, as I indicated, we're trying to do what we can do to try to resolve something with respect to that. But it seems a shame to, given the long track record and the fact that we are only adding two homes to this roadway, that this could be an issue in which perhaps there may not be a solution.
Okay. Any further comments or questions from the board? Hearing none, any comments from the town planner?
I wanted to note that in the memo, I think I identified for the board that I would suggest that the building envelope for Lot 2 be adjusted slightly. Right now, it reflects a building area that's also in an RP2 wetland, and I know the applicant doesn't intend to use that.
I suggested that while you must have been changing the tape, so we're all set on that. Do I hear a motion?
Chair.
Mr. Potter.
Motion for the board to consider finding of facts. Fitzpatrick Associates is requesting a public access waiver to create two lots, U27-28, located on Puputa Drive. Number two, the applicant has submitted an opinion from his attorney that the division of lots and conveyances as proposed does not create a subdivision or alter a previously recorded subdivision. Number three, completed HHE-200 forms are needed for each lot to confirm that adequate subsurface disposal is available to make the lots buildable. Number four, adequate sizing and design of the culvert proposed underneath Puputa Drive is needed to preserve access to the site during heavy stormwater flows. Number five, to preserve the continued accessibility of the proposed lots for emergency vehicles. No change to the access approved by the planning board should occur without planning board approval. Number six, the development substantially complies with the requirements of section 19-4-2B, public access waiver. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Fitzpatrick Associates for a public access waiver to create two lots, U-27 and 28, located off Papuda Drive, be approved with the following conditions. Number one, the completed HHE-200 forms be submitted to the code enforcement administrator and approved prior to construction. Number two, that the 24-inch culvert be installed with a smooth wall as described in the town engineer's letter dated 3/11/97. Number three, that the declaration of road easement and maintenance agreement be revised to delete the last sentence in section 3, page 2. Number four, that the deeds for the lots include binding covenants that access for the lots shall be in compliance with the planning board approved plans. And number five, that there be no alteration of the site nor building permit issued until plans have been revised and the above conditions have been met.
Is there a second to the motion?
Second.
Mr. Parker?
Do we need to say anything in this part about the building envelope lot two being adjusted?
Yes.
Okay, so I'll make that.
I agree to the revision, whatever wording Maureen suggests.
Okay, how about the suggestion that the building envelope for lot two be revised to delete any incursion into the wetlands at the southern end of the lot?
I'll second that as
new number proposed. Five.
Mm-hmm. And number that number five, and then make the earlier number five be number six, which would be the last. Mr. Parker, is that that acceptable to Mr. Potter, and then acceptable to Mr. Parker?
Can I suggest that however we want to word it, if the applicant agrees, that we also include that They will investigate the possibility of at least moving the utility pole to provide better access. Better site visibility along Sproing. Would you agree to that? Mm-hmm. However you want to word it.
Mm-hmm. So let's say that the applicant make reasonable efforts.
Or at least demonstrate that efforts have been made.
Or that the applicant request CMP to move the utility pole in a manner to improve site distance at the intersection. That doesn't mean that CMP has to agree, but that you have to make reasonable and hopefully best efforts to get them to do that.
While we're on that, is there a street sign that could be moved as well with the town's cooperation? If I'm not mistaken, wasn't there one on near the site?
I think there's a blind drive sign.
Yeah.
That's south. It's not in the way.
It's not in the way?
I don't think so.
Okay, I haven't seen it.
I have a call into Bob Malley on that sign. He's on vacation right now.
Just to clarify, it's the north. It's the direction looking north that we're talking about. The direction south, it's really fine.
There is another sign on the south, on the looking north.
Oh, okay, maybe I missed that one.
Okay, we have a motion that has been seconded and has been amended, and the amendments are acceptable. Is there any further discussion on the motion? All in favor, raise your right hand. It's unanimous.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Is there any other business to come before the meeting? Seeing and hearing none, the meeting is adjourned. Thank you.